Right now, we're at a spot that we often refer to as Lagoon Island. Being relatively surrounded by water and separated from the more, you know, important infrastructure around campus, we are able to practice a really kind of unique form of restoration out here in the form of prescribed or controlled burns used as a tool for trying to get rid of and eliminate non-native invasive grass species. So a prescribed burn, I would kind of define as fire used in an intentional way in a controlled setting over a specified area to achieve specific purposes or goals. Sometimes it can be for restoration, other times it can be for fuel reductions, but generally the idea is to have it managed and obviously within your control and not burning things that you don't intend to. So at the end of summer, we conducted a prescribed burn out here, as we've done every other year for almost the better part of the last decade. And we burned this roughly almost 3/4 of an acre behind me as a means of getting rid of the invasive grasses that were out here. The following winter, just before our rain started coming in, I spread probably hundreds of thousands of wildflower seeds of our various native wildflower species found in our area out here. And what you see behind me is the result of that. The history of the lagoon, I like to think of, is very similar to the history of California in that it has experienced some pretty severe changes and disturbances in the last couple hundred years. All these disturbances over time kind of resulted in an elimination and loss of many of the native plant species that would have originally been found out here. And essentially, we've kind of been having to work back from ground zero as far as trying to reestablish native plant communities out here. So what these fires are able to achieve and the reason we do them is actually based on research that was done by a graduate student here at UCSB. Her name's Alice Levine. What she found in her research was that by having a hot, intense fire, if you could heat the soil to around 200 degrees Celsius, you could reduce the seed bank of the grasses, so the seeds of the grasses still in the soil, by upwards of 99%. I think she found in 1 square meter, you could go from like 10,000 viable seeds to about 100. And it almost gives you this wonderful blank slate to work with. And that allows us to come in and seed really heavily with native wildflower seeds, do some follow-up weeding to get the grasses and other non-native species that make it through the fire, and create these spaces where we have almost, you know, 100% native cover in some instances. Some of our wildflower species are indeed what we would describe as fire followers. So fire is a part of our native plant communities and native plant ecosystems, and many of the species found therein are well adapted to it. The area behind me was, you know, almost 90 plus to 100% solid non-native invasive grass species. Really low diversity, really low habitat value, relatively high fire danger. These annual grasses tend to be one of the earliest things to dry out and one of the more easy things to catch and burn. A lot of our native plant communities are actually much more resistant to fire than a lot of people realize. It obviously adds a ton more diversity, so there's all these floral and nectar and seed resources made available for all the wildlife, insects, what have you. And the obvious difference is just the drastic increase in diversity behind me, the abundance of color. One of my favorite things about these burn plots is kind of the sequence of blooms you get, the change in phenology going from red maids to poppies to phacelia to nuttallanthus, all these different species that bloom at different times and sometimes at the same time as well, but providing just a cascade of colors throughout a much longer period of the year as opposed to just, you know, the green and then to brown of these non-native grasses. You know, it is this island of habitat surrounded by a relative large amount of development. And I think it's important that in these areas that we do actually have the resources to manage and protect to try and have as much local native biodiversity as possible. I think what's behind me is quite novel and really exciting. I would struggle to think of an area within 30 miles of here that looks like what is behind me and has this abundance of native wildflowers. It is pretty special, and so I think would be something worth managing for. And something that's been very exciting to me is just seeing how many people stop and look at this and take pictures and ask me questions about it and want to know more. And I think, you know, for the purpose of maybe getting people more interested and more aware of what California used to look like, could look like, should look like, and what is native and local to the areas they live, is really exciting.